Our pro vice chancellor joined. Have you checked?
Yes, I just called. Give me a moment.
It is now 8 o'clock. We can go ahead, Varsh.
Sir, he is just logging in. Should we wait for a couple of minutes or should we start?
He's logging.
Yeah, he's logging in.
Yeah, I think you can start within a minute or so.
Okay. Sir, PVC sir is here.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Go ahead, start.
So, namaste to all. Respected speaker, Professor Martin Berg, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Suhas Pednekar sir, Pro Vice Chancellor, Ravindra Kulkarni sir, distinguished members of the scientific fraternity and my dear friends, a very warm welcome to all of you for this first lecture by Professor Martin Berg. Professor Berg, I'm taking the liberty to say it's the first lecture so that you keep on coming again and again to our university to address. It's an honor indeed to convene this program under the able guidance of our Honorable Vice Chancellor and Pro Vice Chancellor. I've also had the privilege to shake hands, though virtually, with Professor Martin Berg on various scientific ideas, and I feel that they need to be transpired to as many as possible. And that is the reason, Professor Berg, we would like to hear your ideas, share your thoughts, and take this ahead so that it's in the benefit of the entire scientific fraternity. We are all here eagerly waiting to hear your address. And I think without wasting any further time, may I call upon our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Suhas Pednekar, sir, for his opening remarks. Pednekar, sir, over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Martin Berg from Illinois University, Dr. Tsorgere, our friend, I would say, Professor Kulkarni, Pro Vice Chancellor, and all other distinguished and eminent personalities who have joined this particular program to listen to Professor Martin Berg on a topic which is so interesting, and myself being organic chemist, I'm also looking forward. It's a very, very happy that the University of Mumbai is organizing a talk by Professor Martin Berg. Very recently, University of Mumbai achieved one more milestone of securing the highest grade from National Assessment and Accreditation Council, which is the A++ with the CGPA 3.65. And we all are so happy that that has given us some more, I would say, momentum and the strength to take university forward. And on the background of National Education Policy 2020, where there are going to be a lot of reforms and the whole dynamics of higher education system in India is going to change. And we need to prepare ourselves. And this is one of the beginning, I would say, where extending our hands with the well-known researchers and professors from the universities abroad and the universities which have earned the reputation. And University of Mumbai will be very happy to explore all such possible collaborations which will benefit our students, our faculty, and more so our researchers, and how we can come together with the vertical boundaries getting dissolved now And the technology platform is, you know, giving us such a wonderful opportunity wherever we may be, but we can get connected at any time. And well, thanks to the COVID situation, which we are still going through for more than 1.5 years, but whatever challenges we have come across, and we are still in the same process, I would say. But we all know the challenges also provide us opportunities. And I would say this is one of them where we are using this technology very meaningfully. And with the advent of, I would say, Industrial Revolution 4.0, and the way the IT and artificial intelligence and digital technology is being used now everywhere, it is our responsibility to explore all such possible ways of, you know, connecting with one another. And that will provide a great platform for our new generation of students or faculty. And in this background, I'm very happy that University of Mumbai, which is Dr. Solgade knows the vastness of University of Mumbai. I do not know how far Professor Martin Burke knows about university, but it may take some time for him even to realize that we are taking care of more than 850 colleges affiliated to University of Mumbai, with a huge number of population of students. Even the geographical area is spreading over 720 kilometers of the stretch. So it's one of the largest universities in the country. And even a lot of heterogeneity in that sense, I would say, right from urban to semi-urban to rural, including some part of our jurisdiction is also the tribal area. So it's a real challenge of taking care of the students coming from different strata of society. And at the same time, we have to ensure that we need to move with the fastest speed with the world. And today we are going to make a beginning with a talk by Professor Martin Burke, a very well-known personality from the University of Illinois, from the field of chemistry. So it is my privilege and honor to welcome you once again, Professor Martin Burke, as well as Dr. Solgade. Solgade is, I would say, acting as a catalyst between University of Mumbai and all other the possibilities where he is helping us to explore the collaborations with the leading universities abroad. We're going to meet you very soon in USA to take it forward. So thank you very much, Professor Varsha, and back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir. Now may I invite the facilitator and catalyst of this entire session, Professor Mukund Solgade, who's an eminent scientist, academician, a person from the industry, and friend, philosopher, and guide of not one but many. Professor Solgade, over to you to introduce Professor Martin Burke, and then Professor Burke, it's all yours.
So, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have an extraordinary collection of academicians, industry personnel, and even government that has been specially convened for this extremely joyous occasion by Professor Varsha Kelkar Mane and my partner Uday Ohale. And this truly is a very momentous occasion for us. It's the beginning of the festival of Diwali and so on, during which time many new and wonderful initiatives are launched, conceived, and finally implemented. Exactly 50 years ago, I had the pleasure of listening to another very distinguished organic chemist, Professor R.B. Woodward, who, in a speech at the University of Mumbai and the Siba Gaigi Research Center, said, "The art and science of organic synthesis is one that is more easily exemplified and epitomized than it is articulated and summarized." Now, Professor Woodward was legendary. But today, I'm bringing to you, with Marty Burke's able abilities, that he's somebody who can even articulate and summarize the magic of organic synthesis, how it can be used to spread this whole gospel of making molecules which are going to be extraordinarily beneficial to the common man. The biographical details of Marty are fairly well known, how he went for an undergraduate education at Johns Hopkins, worked with another eminent organic chemist like Gary Posner, and finally did his MD, PhD degrees at Harvard, working with the mentorship of Stuart Schreiber, who is well known to many in India, works on natural products and so on. Now, when Marty launched his independent career, of course, he's done an extraordinary job of organic synthesis. My first interactions with him came when he propounded this theory that all organic chemists and others should unite under the banner of making the natural product tome. And that word is spreading far and wide. But even more of extraordinary importance is Marty Burke's commitment to both entrepreneurship, education, and bringing in not necessarily just the organic chemists into this extraordinary loop of innovation, entrepreneurship, business creation, and so on. Now, he exemplifies that better than anybody else. He has set up companies, he has taught chemistry, he has mentored students and postdocs and so on. But what is most noticeable about Marty is something that used to be said even about Professor R.B. Woodward, that all the lectures are characterized with the lucidity of style, clarity and felicity of expression and so on. And Marty has, I think, scaled up new heights into that one. So this is a truly momentous occasion, which is ably catalyzed at the University of Mumbai. And you will all recognize the fact that University of Illinois executives did come to Mumbai to set up strategic relationships. And I'm very optimistic that will go very much further. Marty has the unique distinction of having an MD both in front of his name and also behind his name because of his MD degree. And Marty, it's a great pleasure for me to welcome you to my home city of my home state of Maharashtra, and so on and so forth. But I feel that this will be the launch of a truly momentous movement where we bring the citizen scientists, and in a particular tribute to Dr. Ashok Vaidya, all of you will be called as Vaidya scientists who will preach, do research, who will conduct some very extraordinarily scholarly work, which will be very, very beneficial to the common man. So without much further ado, Maestro Marty, the floor is all yours.
Professor Trogati, thank you so much for the incredibly kind and very generous introduction. I am so excited to have this opportunity that you have made possible. Vice Chancellor Pednekar, thank you so much for the very kind welcoming and allowing me to have this opportunity to speak with your amazing colleagues and students. And Professor Kelkar, thank you for your tremendous friendship and partnership. I couldn't be more grateful for the chance to spend the time with you this morning. So hopefully everyone can now see my slides. Is that okay? Yes, okay. Well, thank you again. And I am very excited to share our story of how we here are imagining and look forward to imagining together a world where everyone can make molecules. So why would this be important? Well, if we think historically, to me, it's very fascinating to put into context tool making as it relates to where we are as a society. One can argue this is where we became human. And 3 million years ago, the onset of tool making defined us as a society, which ultimately has thenceforth revolutionized everything that we do in our society today. And over the last 3 million years, we've gotten really good at making tools. And in fact, over the last several hundred years, there's been an inflection point. And the power of innovation powerfully accelerated across the globe, and many new tools were created that changed the lives for so many people in so many positive ways. Well, when we think about tool making on the molecular scale, it's really inspirational to recognize we've only been doing this on purpose for about 200 years. So relative to that 3 million year timeframe, we are in our infancy of intentionally creating tools on the molecular scale. And despite that, there have been some amazing tools that have been developed already. Of course, we know that organic molecules can capture light from the sun and help convert it into electricity, a technology that is going to be critical for us to move forward in a sustainable way as society. Small molecules can conduct electricity and participate in the creation of new devices that are a fraction of the size of those that we use today, and therefore could be even implanted in the body and provide regular readout of how we are doing, providing the opportunity to intervene very early against disease. Small molecules can create lasers, they can create screens for our cell phones, and they can even create batteries that allow us to store and use energy on demand. If we look into biotechnology, we of course know that small molecules have a tremendous history of defining and helping us create the medicines for tomorrow. And small molecule natural products in particular have been the source of inspiration for most of the drugs that we're able to use today to treat disease. And when we look at the future goals of biotechnology and what functions we're aiming to accomplish, many of the natural products that we already know about perform some of the most extraordinary higher order functions that are being targeted. This includes disrupting protein-protein interactions, molecules that even bring two proteins together to form a tri-complex, molecules that can bind outside the active site of a protein, cause a subtle twist and thereby modify its biology, and even small molecules that can autonomously perform protein-like function. And this latter group, for us, was a tremendous inspiration to ask whether it might be possible to replace missing proteins with small molecule counterparts. And this led us to launch the field of what we call molecular prosthetics. These are small molecules that act like missing proteins. So if you have a disease caused by a deficiency of protein function, for example, this iron transporting protein, if that protein is missing, you end up not being able to transport iron across lipid bilayers, causing anemia. But that iron then builds up upstream of that missing protein, and we discovered a small molecule, this natural product called henokidiol, isolated from the bark of the hinoki tree in Taiwan, can wrap around an iron atom to create a lipophilic complex, which can then transport iron across lipid bilayers and recover this missing function. And if you look in a zebrafish, you can see this process in action. So this is a normal zebrafish, and this is their blood stained with dionysidine. If you knock out their iron transporter, they cannot transport iron, and so the zebrafish becomes severely anemic. And if you simply then add the small molecule to the fish tank, the zebrafish recover the capacity to transport iron and recover hemoglobinization. Here, a small molecule replacing a missing protein. To our knowledge, the first example of that in a whole animal. And we think this has tremendous potential, as I'll show you in the talk today, for a general approach for treating diseases caused by missing protein function. Now, pulling all of this together and thinking about how powerful we know small molecules can be in society, to us, it's really striking to recognize that we are currently up against a tremendous synthesis bottleneck. So as huge progress has been made, as Professor Trigati mentioned at the beginning, some of the luminaries of the field have allowed us to feel confident that any molecule that could exist could be made in the laboratory. The problem is that's not enough. We need to be able to make molecules quickly, on demand, discover what they can do, and then make another one over and over and over again to finally figure out what ultimate function can be achieved. And for those of us who make molecules for a living, we are constantly running into this synthesis bottleneck. The process via which we make the molecules ends up being the slow step in our efforts to discover the amazing function that they can perform. Now, there's a second, and I think even more important way to understand this synthesis bottleneck, is that if we imagine this represents the barriers for those who get to participate in the molecule making process. So currently, those of us who can make molecules, you could put us in one building. Now, it's a very tall building, but it probably is a single building. Relative, we have 7.5 billion imaginations in the world. We are therefore missing out on so many untapped imaginations when we think about molecular innovation. So can you imagine if we could shatter these barriers and open up access for molecule making to everyone? Just think about the tremendous untapped innovation potential that we as a global society would gain access to. And we're very inspired by what computer science did with coding. And if you think about, they made coding as accessible as possible. And this, of course, allowed people from all over the world, young and old, shy and bold, to quote Professor Chirgati, everyone feels empowered and enabled to participate. And therefore, we get these amazing apps from all over the world that we all then use to communicate better and share information and solve problems. How amazing would it be if we could do the same thing with molecular innovation? So everyone can play in the sandbox and brilliant ideas come from wherever lightning strikes. And we as a society then benefit from those new discoveries at the molecular scale. So this is our mission and our goal. And we are so excited to think about building a global consortium around this effort to achieve this really transformative outcome. Okay, so how do we do it? Well, here's for us a very inspiring takeoff point, and we think it has tremendous power. If you look back again to the macroscopic scale, how is it possible over the last 300 to 400 years that we saw this industrial revolution sweep across the globe and new innovations and scalable technologies appeared all over the place? And the argument is this was because of modularization. So when you really think about the onset of the industrial revolution, it was the creation of standardized parts and even automated Lego-like assembly of everything from cars to buildings to space stations. You can name a list. We modularized both the innovation and then the manufacturing process. And this allowed democratization of macro-scale innovation. And if you need any more evidence for this, you just give your kid a bucket of Lego bricks and watch them go to town. It's amazing how powerful building block-based construction can be. And it's not only just the final thing that you make, it's the process. So kids will build up a Lego structure and then they'll tear it down as fast as possible. And they'll build up another one and tear it down. And it's the process of being able to rapidly create new things, hold it in front of you and decide if you like what it does or looks like or not, and then tear it apart again and make it again. And so the power of modular construction for creativity stimulation, I think, is one of the most exciting aspects. And so the question is, can we modularize and thereby democratize molecule making? Well, there's a lot of reasons to feel optimistic that the answer is yes, because it's already happened on three fronts. So if we look at polypeptides, oligonucleotides, and increasingly oligosaccharides, we of course now have machines that can take building blocks suitably protected and enabled for assembly in an iterative fashion, and then the machines iteratively snap those building blocks together. And now students don't even oftentimes do this themselves in the lab. You go onto a computer, you can dial in the sequence of the building blocks, and then a company can put them together and send them to you. So there's some amazing power that comes along with modularization and automation that really allows you to think about making molecules on demand with a computer. And so to us, this is a very inspiring takeoff point to think about how we might go after this problem. Now, you'll recognize none of these machines can make small molecules. This is the class of chemical matter that we started the talk with. These are molecules built primarily from carbon-carbon bonds, and they have extraordinary, unique functional properties. So in order to harness all of this untapped functional potential, we need to figure out how to modularize, even automate, and thereby democratize small molecule synthesis. Well, when we think about how to accomplish this, we look to nature as an inspiring takeoff point. And that is because nature is the master of building block-based construction. So she makes everything with building blocks. It's an amazing thing if you think about the way in which life has evolved and why it has been so successfully able to adapt to changing environments and discovering new function. It's because everything comes back to simple building block sets. So polypeptides, of course, use just the 20 amino acids. The nucleosides, five if you switch back and forth between RNA and DNA, and then a bounded set of oligosaccharides, and collectively nature makes so many of the functional molecules from these same blocks. Well, it turns out natural products are no different. So one of the things that always struck me as a student of the field of organic synthesis is that for a very long time, the field has celebrated making every molecule as differently as possible. In fact, we often start papers by proclaiming, here we made a molecule different than anyone's ever made it before. It's very interesting to think that that's exactly the opposite way that nature makes complex natural products. In fact, nature uses only 4 major biosynthetic pathways and about 5 building blocks total to make almost all the natural products that we know about that have launched so many new drugs and so many new other functional discoveries. And this really suggests that there is an inherent modularity to natural products that remains largely untapped. These molecules were born from building blocks, and therefore it should be possible to bring them back to a collection of building blocks on the shelf from which most natural products could be made. So with that in mind, we also look at other important chemical matter in the small molecule class, like drugs and materials. And if you look close, you start seeing building blocks everywhere. So there's been some very thoughtful analyses of all the known drugs. This very exciting review article that came out recently, and it turns out there are a certain subset of building blocks that are used over and over again in many different drug products, suggesting there's an inherent functional potential in those building blocks that give them drug-like properties that can be used to make many other types of functional small molecule biological interrogators. We also look at materials and we see the same thing. These are probably the easiest to recognize as building block-based architectures that could be reduced to modular units that could be assembled and thereby creating new function. And so if you put all of that together, we would put forth, this could be the future of organic synthesis, is imagine a Lego kit for molecules where all the building blocks you need are on the shelf. There's a machine in the middle of the room that can snap those building blocks together. And now you shift the bottleneck in molecular innovation away from synthesis and turn it to human imagination. That is, the bottleneck becomes your ability to imagine new function that could solve society problems, and we get the synthesis bottleneck out of the way. And so this has been the goal that we've been aiming for, and I'm very excited to tell you some of the progress that we've made in this direction today. Okay, so how do you create a Lego kit for small molecules? And what we recognize, what we need is a common platform, a general way to snap those building blocks together that can be done iteratively and in a controlled manner. And again, we were very inspired by peptide coupling. So as many of you know, this process works by taking a bifunctional reagent, right? This is an amino acid that has an electrophilic carboxylic acid and a nucleophilic amine. And one end of that bifunctional reagent is protected, or its reactivity is reversibly attenuated. And this is the form, for example, of an FMOC group. And so that bifunctional monoprotected amino acid can selectively undergo a coupling reaction with a free amine coupling to the open carboxylic acid to generate a new amide bond. Now the second functional group, the other amine, does not react because the FMOC group is blocking its reactivity, and that allows you to perform that amide bond reaction selectively. You don't get, for example, oligomers of another building block being added. Then in a separate step, you can remove the FMOC group, regenerate the amine, and this sets you up now for a second round of coupling with another building block. And then the entire process just gets repeated over and over and over again. So it ends up being an incredibly simple way to make what turns out to be a very complex product. If you think about peptides, many different functional groups, oxidation states, stereochemistry, of course they do amazing functional things, and yet the making process is so simple. So the question we asked is, could we develop an analogous, simple, general, iterative process via which you could make complex small molecule natural products, materials, drugs, and many other types of compounds? And the idea again was very simple. We created a bifunctional building block, and we decided to focus on the palladium-mediated cross-coupling chemistry as the anchor. So if you're going to pick one reaction and try to make all small molecules using that same approach, this reaction rapidly rises to the top, an incredibly powerful, functional group tolerant, and increasingly general way to stitch together carbon-carbon, and now increasingly carbon heteroatom and carbon oxygen and nitrogen bonds. And the idea is very simple. You take, in this case, the free boronic acid, and we took a halide and another boronic acid, and the latter we put into the same building block. So we create a bifunctional reagent, which could be theoretically coupled iteratively over and over again. And to avoid oligomerization, we discovered that this ligand, N-methylaminodiacetic acid, or MIDA, when it wraps around a boron center, it converts the boron p orbital from the boron center from sp2 to sp3, and thereby removes the p orbital and blocks the critical transmetallation step in the palladium cross coupling. And so as a result, we can now selectively couple the free boronic acid and the halide terminus to generate a now new middleboronate product. And then under very mild conditions, we can deprotect that middleboronate, regenerate a boronic acid, and now the entire process can be repeated, okay, over and over and over again. And so just like peptide synthesis, you can imagine small molecule synthesis proceeding through one reaction performed in iteration using only pre-assembled bifunctional building blocks. So I'll show you an example, okay, of how we were able to reduce this idea to practice. And this is a very interesting natural product called peridinin. It's isolated from the dinoflagellate that causes the red tide. It's one of the most abundant molecules on our planet because it's one of the key molecules nature uses to harness sunlight and thereby convert it into energy. So it's a very exciting molecule from many different angles. It's also, as you can see, a very complex molecule. We have many different functional groups, oxidation states, a lot of stereochemistry issues, including this alene, which is another stereogenic center, all of which have to be taken care of if you're going to create a synthesis. And four different groups had worked on synthesizing this molecule in the past, but consistent with its challenging nature, none of them had completed a fully stereo-controlled total synthesis. So we thought it was a very fair test for this new idea that we could make this complex molecule using only one reaction and pre-assembled blocks. So my student, Eric Worley, looked at this compound and imagined that this could have come from four building blocks, okay, as indicated by the corresponding colors. And the dark lines represent where we imagine snapping those blocks together. And so retrosynthetically, if you break that back down and then move that into the forward direction, this process worked beautifully. So we start with this blue building block. And one of the key features you can see is that all the functional groups, all the oxidation states, and all the stereochemistry have been pre-installed into the building block. Okay, this is one of the key features of this approach. And thereby, because the palladium-mediated coupling is stereospecific, the stereochemistry in the building blocks is faithfully translated into the stereochemistry of the new product. And so asymmetric synthesis is now reduced to picking the red bottle or the blue bottle. So you can just decide which stereochemistry you want based on which bottle that you pick, as opposed to trying to set those stereocenters in the process. And so here we take this first building block, we do a deprotection with sodium hydroxide to generate the boronic acid. And then we do one of these selective couplings with a bifunctional building block. So the halo boronic acid protected as its middleboronate counterpart, we get a selective carbon-carbon bond formation, and then we get our new middleboronate product. The rest of the synthesis is exactly the same. We simply do a deprotection and a coupling again, and then finally a deprotection and a coupling again. And you'll notice in this last step, we have two stereocenters, the double bond and the alene, and both of them undergo retention of configuration in this stereospecific final cross-coupling step. Final deprotection yielded peridinin for the first time in a fully stereo-controlled fashion, and really excitingly, I think, showing that this very simple approach could be used to make very complex molecules. And we were really inspired by seeing how well this worked in this context. Now, when we went out and started talking about this, and we were very enthusiastic that we could make many different types of molecules using the same approach, but there was pushback. People argued to us, well, this works well for these linear molecules, but what about these very complex polycyclic natural products, which have many sp3 stereocenters and many rings kind of wrapped amongst a very small amount of space? You could never make these molecules using this kind of simple Lego-like approach. Well, I was very fortunate to have an amazing graduate student, Jin-Shi Lee, and she took this as a challenge and said, okay, people say this is impossible. Let me figure out how I can do it. And she designed a strategy that inspired by nature's approach to these molecules. So let's take oblongolide as an example. It's a very complex natural product. Of course, lots of interesting challenges, quaternary stereogenic centers, lots of densely packed arrayed carbocyclic framework. Remarkably, nature makes this molecule from this simpler linear precursor, which undergoes a macrocyclization and then a transannular Diels-Alder reaction to generate this very densely packed carbocyclic skeleton. And that linear molecule comes from simple building blocks. The same thing is true with the secodaphnane core. So again, here now, very complex, pentacyclic, all sp3, multiple quaternary stereogenic centers, et cetera. The molecule actually comes from a simple linear precursor, which undergoes intramolecular cyclization processes, and that linear precursor comes from simple building blocks. And so the idea is this is almost like protein folding, except it's covalent. So of course, nature takes amino acids, links them together, makes linear peptides, and then they fold up right into a three-dimensional protein shape. And so what Jinshi got excited about is maybe we could do the same thing with small molecules, is use building blocks to make linear things and then cyclize them at the end, kind of like protein folding. And so she went after this problem, and I'm very excited to show you just one of the many examples that she was able to reduce to practice, this very complex cyclodaphanine core inspired by some beautiful work from Hethcock and coworkers. Imagine a retrosynthesis that's biomimetic. So this kind of transender Prinz type cyclization, Diels-Alder pathway, et cetera, gets us back to this linear precursor, which can then be deconstructed into simple building blocks. And so this one looks very intimidating and scary, but the linear molecule actually looks very amenable to the Lego-like approach. So that transformation back to a linear substrate is the key. And then in the forward direction, she was able to put this together beautifully. So this sp3 sp2 cross-coupling reaction, the midoborinate does not get reacted under that context, then a deprotection and a coupling again to the green building block, and then finally a biomimetic polycyclization process converts this linear molecule into this very densely packed polycyclic framework, showing a tremendous amount of potential for making very complex things in a very simple way. So I'd also really love to share with you a story of how this chemistry can help us solve problems. That is, because it's very modular, it's very efficient and very flexible, you can think about it as an engine to understand and thereby harness the functional potential that small molecules possess. So one of the functional goals that my lab has been dreaming about from the beginning is this question of, can we replace missing proteins with small molecule counterparts? And as I showed you an example earlier in the talk, we're making some really exciting progress in the direction. That progress has been driven by this Lego chemistry. So when I was a student, as Professor Trigati mentioned, I did an MD PhD. So in the US, that means I went to medical school for 2 years, then I went and did a PhD in organic chemistry, and then I went back and finished my medical degree. And so I was running back and forth between the hospital and the organic chemistry lab, sometimes the same day, running back and forth between the two. It was an incredibly inspiring experience. And I saw firsthand the amazing power of small molecules in the context of human medicine. And it sounds so simple, but I tell you, when you see it live, a patient who's sick, and then you give them a chemical and then watch the patient get better, it's an amazing thing to witness. And it inspired me to try to go find new molecules that could do that. And one of the things that also really struck me was, if your disease is caused by too much protein function, of course, small molecules are really good at binding to proteins and turning them off. That's how most drugs work. But if instead your disease is caused by a deficiency of protein function, if you're fundamentally missing something, in many ways, the classic paradigm of pharmacology falls apart, because by definition, there is no protein target to inhibit. And so the question became, given how powerful small molecules can be as medicines, might it be possible to find small molecules that could replace those missing proteins? That is almost operating like a prosthesis on the molecular scale. And this idea came from a conversation with a patient, a brilliant young woman in Boston who was in the hospital. I was trying to help take care of her on my pediatrics rotations, and she had cystic fibrosis. And I remember describing to her in probably way too much detail what was wrong with her protein that was no longer properly functioning as an anion channel and transporting ions across her membrane in her lung. And she stopped me and said, "It sounds like you know exactly what's wrong with me. Why can't you fix it?" And it was a very inspiring, incredibly thoughtful question. And it literally led us down this entire path, because we decided to try to find a way. We know the problem. Can we develop a solution in the form of a small molecule that acts like her missing CFTR anion channel, and thereby a molecular prosthetic to address this very challenging disease? Now, again, we got a lot of pushback from this hypothesis as well, because people told us that proteins are, of course, very complex, very sophisticated, highly selective entities, and they do their job in the context of a very complex system. It's never going to be possible to perfectly replicate a missing protein with a small molecule. And our hypothesis was, in fact, that perfection wasn't necessary, that imperfection would be enough. And this is because we and all other living systems tend to be highly robust. We have a lot more function than we need to do most of the things that are important. In fact, a recent study from the Broad Institute took a bunch of healthy people and sequenced all their genomes and found we're each missing about 100 proteins. And yet we're okay, or at least we think we're okay. And the idea is that we have more than we need to do most of the things that matter. And when we're missing a protein, usually there's no consequence because the inherent redundancy and backup mechanisms is sufficient. It's the rarer case then that you're missing a protein, and as a result, you drop below some threshold concentration and thereby get a phenotype, whether it's a phenotype in a cell or a disease in a person. And so the key is, though, you haven't dropped to zero because all of your backup mechanisms and redundancy are kicking in, trying to get you back to healthy. You just can't quite get there. And so the hypothesis was, if we have a small molecule that even partially replicates the function of this missing protein, in concert with that inherent robustness of a human physiology, you could get that whole system across the threshold and back to healthy. And therefore, the bar, if you will, for the small molecule to perfectly replicate the protein is actually not so high. Okay, so in the context of cystic fibrosis, how could this work? And so, as many of you probably know, in our airway, we have epithelia that have an apical side and a basolateral side. And CFTR, which is the protein missing in cystic fibrosis, sits on the apical side, and it's a passive anion channel that releases bicarbonate and chloride across the apical membrane into the airway surface liquid. Now, if you're missing CFTR, you can't release anions. And as a result, you get a lowering of pH, and bacteria then can grow. And this is why people with CF end up chronically infected with bacteria in their lungs. Now, the problem is that CFTR is not allowing anions to exit, but the anions are certainly being pushed in that direction by the basolateral pumps and channels on the surface on the basolateral side. And so the hypothesis was, because this system is very robust and these other proteins are working actually overtime to try to get the anions across, that if we could create a separate opportunity for those anions to be released, therefore the overall gradient that has built up because of the basolateral pumps and channels, that gradient would be sufficient to cause those anions to make it across to the apical side. And so the small molecule doesn't need to be driving the anions. It probably doesn't even need to be selective for anions over cations because there's a context-dependent, direction-selective anion flow that we're reestablishing homeostasis with the small molecule. And so we wanted to find a small molecule that could do this to ask this question. And to make a long story short, we found one. So this is this amazing natural product called amphotericin B. Rather than design an ion channel ourselves, we got very inspired by the fact that this molecule already forms ion channels. It's been known to do so for decades. It's an amazing natural product. It evolved probably over hundreds of millions of years, and it has this remarkable capacity to form ion channels in both yeast and human cells. Now, the challenge, the problem was, it was thought that this molecule was also killing cells by forming channels. So amphotericin is known to be a highly toxic molecule, and the channel activity was thought to be critical to its toxicity. If that were true, this would of course make it very difficult to use that channel to recover physiology in the absence of a missing protein. And so to make a long story short again, we decided to investigate this mechanism in great detail, and after a lot of work found that the ion channel is in fact not the killing mechanism for amphotericin. And I'll show you very briefly how we got there using the LEGO chemistry. And so specifically, there was a hypothesis that this hydroxyl group that initially existed on the C35 unit was critical for the channel formation. And we had a hunch that, in fact, the channel formation was not causing the cell killing. So we used this LEGO-like approach to make a derivative of amphotericin that's missing that one key hydroxyl group. And so again, we simply take our building blocks, D-protect couple, and then macrocyclize. And now we make a derivative, which that hydroxyl group is missing. Now we discovered that that molecule binds to sterols in membranes, but does not form ion channels, and yet it still kills the cells. And so this allowed us to separate and prove that the channel activity was not the killing mechanism. We took this further and discovered that amphotericin actually works by self-assembling on the surface of the membrane and physically extracting sterols from the lipid bilayer. And this is the primary killing mechanism. We were even able to get a picture of it. So this is an electron microscope of this sterol sponge sitting on the surface of the lipid bilayer. And very recently, I'm excited to tell you, we've now got a high resolution structure of the amphotericin sterol sponge using solid state NMR spectroscopy in collaboration with Chad Reinstra and his students. So putting all of this together, it gave us a new model for how amphotericin works. We know that it kills cells by forming this extra membranous sterol sponge aggregate. It also then forms ion channels, but these are not the killing mechanism. And knowing this allowed us to separate the two so we could harness the channel activity without hurting the cells. And so this allowed us to ask whether you could replace missing proteins with small molecule ion channel counterparts, in this case with CFTR. And we used as a comparator this molecule, ivacaftor, which has recently been developed by Vertex as a way to treat CF in people who have a specific mutation caused by G551D mutation in CFTR. So this is a particular mutation of the CFTR channel that causes it to misfold and not conduct anions across the membrane properly. So it's a gating mutation. And this small molecule binds to the protein and opens it back up so it can do its job. And it causes an increase in pH, a decrease in viscosity, decrease in bacterial infections, and most importantly, an increase in the performance in clinical studies in the FEV1 or expiratory volume. So using this as a chemical probe, we were able to take airway epithelia from a person with CF who has this G551D mutation. And now we could compare the clinically approved drug to this approach. And very exciting, we saw that if you turn the protein back on using the small molecule, you see a nice increase in bicarb secretion and pH. Alternatively, if you simply add a small molecule ion channel, we similarly see an increase in bicarb and an increase in pH. So this small molecule channel is leading to an outcome very similar to turning the protein itself back on. Now, we also showed this works in a wide range of different mutations. These are in epithelia derived from people with CF who donated their lungs at a transplant. And again, time and time again, we saw really nice recovery of pH, viscosity, and antibacterial activity. We were also able to show this in pigs. So developed by Mike Welsh at Iowa, a pig model for CF, and 4 out of 4 of those pigs recovered their ASLPH. And then we were also able to team up with an amazing young woman called Emily Kramer-Golenkoff, who has CF, but cannot benefit from the modulators because her mutation makes no protein. And this is a common challenge. And so she very courageously started her own foundation, raised millions of dollars and funds research to support CFTR replacement therapies like ours and other approaches that don't rely on the protein being present. And so with funding from Emily's entourage, we were able to do a little clinical study in 8 people with CF. We put amphotericin into their nose, and very excitingly, in 7 out of 8 people, we saw recovery of the nasal potential difference consistent with recovery of the anion channel activity in their nose, similar in direction and magnitude to what was seen with ivacaftor in the clinic, and thereby, we think, offering a lot of promise for taking this into a new therapy. And so I'll just mention, we did spin out a company. Full disclosure, I'm a founder and consultant for the company, and this company is now working very hard to bring this concept in the form of a new dry powdered inhaler that kids with CF could put in their backpack and take with them to school and treat their cystic fibrosis themselves by putting small molecule channels into their airway. Okay, so getting back to the LEGO chemistry, I'm very excited to tell you that now many labs all over the world in academia and industry have used this approach to make many different types of molecules with all kinds of interesting functions. We also built a machine. So analogous to a peptide synthesizer, we created a device, a robot, that can automatically snap these building blocks together to make many different types of small molecules on demand automatically. And we think this represents a really exciting step towards democratizing access to the molecule making process. Many of these building blocks are already now commercially available, which makes it very easy to access them. And if you have a machine in your lab and you can buy the building blocks, this makes it very easy to do molecular discovery. And with that, we started to ask, I think, a very exciting question. And Professor Trigati alluded to this at the outset. How many building blocks would it take to make most natural products? You know, could we create a Lego kit so that most natural products could be made on demand by a machine by simply snapping those blocks together? And the question really comes down to how modular are natural products inherently? And again, as mentioned at the beginning, all the major biosynthetic pathways derive from just 5 building blocks. So this, to us, suggested there should be a bounded set of blocks on the shelf that you could use in the lab to make most natural products. And so we decided to find out. And this is what we call the natural product ohm project. Can we reduce all natural products down to a shelf full of blocks so that we could finally have access to all the amazing functional potential that they possess? So in order to do that, we teamed up with computer scientists and we developed an algorithm. It's kind of like a blender. So it takes all these linear natural products, puts them into a computational algorithm. It really does trillions of retrosyntheses in parallel and then creates many different possible blocks. Then we have an extra component of the algorithm that finds the blocks that are the most redundant. So that is how many, what is the minimum number of blocks we can use to cover the most space? And the output is very exciting. It gives us a collection of blocks, couplings, and a specific total synthesis plan for every natural product. And we think this is a very disruptive, very different way to think about natural product total synthesis. And very excitingly, it tells us that we only need about 1,500 building blocks to make most of the natural products that we know of today. The other really exciting output is it tells us what types of coupling reactions we need to put those blocks together. And now we didn't restrict the algorithm to known couplings. We wanted to know which ones would be the best. So it tells us both about couplings we know how to do, but also it tells us about couplings that we don't yet know how to do, but we could. And this is, I think, a really exciting hit list, if you will, of new methodologies that have to be developed in order to bring this vision into reality. And very interestingly, 14 of the 20 top couplings are SP3 cross couplings. And this, I think, shines a brilliant spotlight on that very exciting frontier of organometallic chemistry. It says we need to figure out how to make and couple SP3 rich building blocks. And the SP3 coupling problem is a very, very interesting problem to dive into. So we and many others are looking very intensely at this. I'll just show you one recent example from our lab. Can we couple a chiral non-racemic secondary boronic acid with an aryl halide? There's lots of exciting momentum in this direction, but doing this stereoretentively with unactivated groups was an unsolved problem. And so our group developed a new catalyst that can do this. The idea again is to create a chiral catalyst that can take stereo-defined building blocks and couple them stereospecifically, okay, as opposed to using chiral catalyst and try to control the stereochemistry in the reaction, which can have trouble, problems in many situations. Here, the beauty is your stereochemistry is in a bottle, okay? So it's a much simpler way to do this. And looking at the cycle of the Suzuki-Miura coupling, the key step here is this transmetallation. Can we take a chiral non-racemic boronic acid, transmetallate to palladium with retention of stereochemistry? And interestingly, in this process, there are in fact two different mechanisms via which you can transfer a chiral non-racemic boronic acid to palladium center. One of them proceeds within the square plane of the palladium complex, and that one is stereoretentive. The other one proceeds from above or below the square plane, and that one is stereoinvertive. So we have a very interesting situation here with competing stereodivergent, stereospecific transition states. It's actually a really interesting problem. And so the question is, could you control the two transition states in the transmetallation step? And our idea for doing so was to try to sterically block above and below the square plane so that you would favor the within square plane retentive pathway, okay, and block it from attacking above or below, and thereby favoring this mechanism. And so we were inspired by a crystal structure of triorthotolyl phosphine that we ultimately expanded upon to generate a solution to this problem. And so you can see here, if you start with triorthotolyl phosphine as the phosphine ligand, we see very low retention of stereochemistry, consistent with this competition. But if instead we start adding bulky groups at the position ortho to the phosphine connection, we start to get a dramatic increase in the enantiospecificity, as well as in the branch linear ratio and the yield. And we got a crystal structure of this catalyst in action. This is the oxidative addition adduct. And you can see, as we had hoped, that the substituents on the orthophenyl ring are projecting above and below the square plane of the palladium complex. And we think this is consistent with this now reaction happening within the square plane and thereby avoiding the invertive transmetallation step. And this chemistry is very exciting because it allows us to take chiral non-racemic secondary boronic acid building blocks and then snap them together with retention of stereochemistry. So this is a very interesting little natural product isolated from this polymorpha. It's called Dead Man's Finger. So you can actually imagine why it gets its name. And it's a very interesting little antifungal compound. Now it has interesting stereochemical challenges, and the synthesis is made challenging because you've got to get all those stereocenters right. Well, here the beauty is we put our stereocenters in a bottle. So we take the blue block and the red block, we simply snap them together using the stereospecific coupling and thereby generate this natural product in a very simple fashion. The beauty is you can also make all of its stereoisomers by simply changing out the building blocks. And because the chemistry is stereospecific, You can make all the different variations of this natural product using the same simple approach. And so we think this really demonstrates this Lego-like concept can be applied even into these sp3-rich molecules. So as we speak, we're working on expanding this Lego kit. If we can go natural products, finally can get into materials and also pharmaceuticals. And you can imagine these Lego kits on a shelf. You can imagine machines that can put these blocks together. And you can even start mixing and matching the Lego kits and make all kinds of interesting function in a very simple, very powerful way. As mentioned at the outset by Vice Chancellor Prendergast, we have a very exciting opportunity as a society to leverage the power of artificial intelligence to help us solve problems. As chemists, we need to figure out how we can take advantage of this amazing emerging technology. And we think this Lego-like chemistry gives us the opportunity to do that. Because now you can imagine coupling artificial intelligence with automated small molecule synthesis, where the machine picks what molecule it wants to make, coupled to automated testing, and then the data goes back to the artificial intelligence. So you can imagine an autonomous or closed loop discovery engine where AI helps us discover the molecules of the future. And we think this is a very exciting frontier that we are just beginning to think about how to explore. And we've gotten a grant from DARPA from the US, which an agency that really helps, likes to invest in these types of very futuristic goals to really help us figure out how to do this with some amazing thought leaders from around the world. With all of that momentum, we put all the pieces together and created what we are very excited to share with you. We call this the Molecule Maker Lab. So we created a facility at the Beckman Institute here at the University of Illinois in partnership with Carl Illinois College of Medicine and created a room filled with robots and equipment and technologies that can accomplish this collection of important things to thereby democratize the process of molecular innovation. So working with Rachel Switsky at the Siebel Center for Design, thinking about how do we inspire and empower and enable increasingly non-specialists to participate in the small molecule synthesis process? Can we then build those molecules automatically with these robotic platforms, validate, and then ultimately share those molecules and their function and the data with the world and create kind of a global ecosystem for democratized molecular innovation? We've been very fortunate to receive an investment from the National Science Foundation to create an institute, which we call the Molecule Maker Lab Institute, which brings together computer scientists, chemists, designers, and citizen scientists from all over the world to try to achieve this really important goal. One example of how we're working together to try to do this is going after the critical challenge of creating molecules that can harness sunlight. So as many of you are aware, of course, we are in a global crisis with respect to environmental impacts of energy use and storage in our society, and we need to figure out a way to switch to clean energy. Organic chemistry has the potential to make a major contribution by a discovery of solar cells based on organophotovoltaics that can be very stable and very efficient. This is the challenge. There are ones that are very stable and there are ones that are efficient. Putting those two properties together is the key challenge. So we're working together with an amazing team to try to bring AI in concert with automated synthesis and automated testing to try to help achieve that goal. We also want to reimagine how we teach chemistry. So once you've got robots that can make molecules, you can completely reimagine how do we inspire our younger colleagues to become chemists and go solve amazing problems. So we've created one strategy. We call this our Molecule Maker Lab in a Box. It's an effort to empower high school and even middle school and even elementary school teachers with the ability to give their students a molecule making experience in the classroom. And so we've teamed up with high schools. This is one of them. And we were able to actually then bring them to the lab and allow them to make molecules themselves using the robotics. So they went home and told their parents they were 3D printing molecules, which they thought was normal. And so we were very excited to see the inspiration on their faces as they go through the process of thinking about how do I imagine myself being a molecule maker of the future. We've teamed up with the National Academy of Science in the US to put forth a workshop to think together about how do we share this technology with the world. We're calling this Empowering Tomorrow's Chemists, and this is going to happen in November of this year. And finally, to wrap things up, I'll tell you a little bit about how we are imagining reaching out to the world and engaging in a collective effort to democratize molecular innovation through fun and exciting competition style approach. So we call this creating our culture of innovation. That's a coin that Ruby Mendenhall coined, a term she coined. And I think Ruby was so excited to be there to visit with you recently at the University of Mumbai. She has envisioned this kind of overall culture of innovation for which molecule making becomes a really critical component. We created this coin, which is worth $10,000 of support, where if you win this competition, you get to take your coin into the Maker Lab and turn your idea into a real prototype. And so the idea here is to, of course, recognize that ideas come from all over. And we as a society will benefit when we level the playing field and lightning strikes, and that idea has a chance to make it into a prototype. And so we love this concept of citizen scientists and voyeur scientists thinking about how do we capture so much imagination potential that we're missing out on. And to do that, we created the Health Maker Lab. So this is now a global yearly competition where we invite ideas from anyone who can apply to submit their idea, and the best ideas win. You don't need to have letters after your name or credentials. It's just all about the best ideas. And so we've been working on building this infrastructure. Professor Chirgati has been a tremendous partner in allowing us to pull this off. This is what the product of this competition can look like. You can imagine this is a really exciting chance to bring people together from many different backgrounds and lots of different perspectives and think about dreaming together of what the future of healthcare could look like. And can we think about molecules as a part of that process? In order to do this, we created a concept that we were really excited about. We call this our dolphin tank. So these are individuals who are absolute experts, frontier thought leaders in the field, but they're also not going to bite you. So it's a chance for people who can get up in front of an audience, pitch their ideas, and get lots of feedback. And those best ideas rise to the top and get a tremendous amount of support to take them forward. And you can see it's a lot of fun. It's a high energy interaction. And Professor Chirgati was very kind to make the trip and be part of our inaugural dolphin tank, and actually has been on every single dolphin tank that we've had since the process started. We get our health makers in the making up on stage. They pitch their concepts. They have to defend their ideas. They get challenging questions from the dolphin tank. And ultimately, those with the best ideas win this $10,000 coin, and they get a chance to go into the Maker Lab and turn their idea into a prototype. We also train them in how to refine their ideas, how to make that idea much more powerful and impactful, and even how to think about entrepreneurship. So they win the opportunity to participate in these classes where they get training and guidance and education around that really important translational step. How do I turn my idea into a new company, and how do I bring that into societal impact? So we have really just gotten started with this effort. We kind of started locally in Champaign. We expanded to Illinois, and now we are so excited to take this global. And we couldn't be more thrilled to have the University of Mumbai as partners as we think about how to do this together. So I'll just close there. This is the extraordinary group of young people that I have the privilege of working with every day here at the University of Illinois. This is the collection of funding agencies that we're tremendously grateful for. Thank you so much again for the very kind invitation to come speak today. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it, and I would be very happy, of course, to answer any questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Martin. There are a lot of questions. Most of them, some of them have been directly put in your chat box, is what I have been told. I too have a couple of questions, but we'll first take the ones which are in the chat box. So just give me a moment till I open my chat box. And after that, there's a message from Professor Mashelkar, and I'll be happy to share that. So Ms. Sunila Navalkar wants to ask, sir, why have we not come up with molecules to fix the COVID virus? That was the first question.
Yeah, it's a really great question. Obviously, we're all struggling through this together as a global society. And as you know, there have been many attempts, and there has been progress. So there are, of course, now Merck in the process of rolling out a small molecule that is shown to be effective in helping to reduce the impact of COVID-19. It's a tremendous challenge. The coronavirus is tricky. It changes. It mutates. This has been one of the biggest challenges, of course, in terms of getting it under control, both with small molecules as well as with vaccines. It's a real challenge. Small molecule antivirals are hard to find, but when we find them, they can be extremely powerful. I think having platforms and technologies available so that when crisis strikes, we can rapidly act and solve some of those challenges is critical. And the coronavirus, of course, is an amazing example for this. So I think there has been progress in chemistry, looking at developing small molecules to treat. Of course, we also, as a field of chemistry, can feel very proud of the vaccines. There's a tremendous amount of chemistry that went into the creation of the nanoparticle technology and the oligonucleotide technology that ultimately came together to create these vaccines. So there has been progress, but of course, it's been tremendously challenging. And I think we need better tools and technologies for rapid on-demand response when these crises strike so that we can do much better next time.
Thank you. The next one is from Dr. Suyog Marathe, and he says that I'm amazed to hear about your journey from MD to PhD. It was indeed great to hear your views and out-of-box work that you're carrying out. As an organic chemist working in the industry, I feel honored to hear you. What made the transition in your life to get lured towards organic chemistry?
So thank you for the question. I'll tell you my story. So I grew up in a very small town in Maryland in the US. So we had more cows than people, okay? And I had never met a scientist. I didn't realize this actually until I looked back once I got to college, but I grew up and I'd never met a scientist. So I grew up dreaming about being a baseball player or a doctor, okay? These were the two things that I was most excited about. The baseball player thing didn't work because I wasn't good enough. And then the doctor thing was what I ended up deciding I wanted to do. And so I had the amazing opportunity to go to the Johns Hopkins University, which is in Maryland, close to my hometown. I got a scholarship and I was so excited to do it. And I got there very much thinking I wanted to be a doctor. And then I discovered organic chemistry and it absolutely blew my mind. I was so excited and fascinated by this ability to actually make molecules. I know it sounds so simple, but there was something so incredibly powerful about that. And in fact, a woman who ended up becoming my wife was an organic chemist. She was there as a graduate student and she inspired me. She told me about all these amazing things she was doing in lab. And I was just blown away by the power of this molecule making process. So I was conflicted. I didn't know what I wanted to do at that point. I still loved medicine and I wanted to be a doctor, but now I had seen the power of making molecules. So I went and did the MD PhD kind of as the non-decision. I didn't want to decide. So I kept my options open. And so I did both degrees. I did an MD and I did a PhD in organic synthesis. And then when I got into Stuart Schreiber's lab and myself actually got to make molecules, that was it. I was absolutely hooked. And seeing the power of that process and end up, you know, feeling like maybe I could make a molecule that could really help move the needle and impact society. I think I'm very much drawn to impact and leverage. And I love the leverage of the molecule making process. And so for me, my choice was to then, I did not even apply to residency. I just applied to academic positions. And then as soon as I finished my MD, I started here at the University of Illinois and never looked back. That said, I absolutely loved my medical experience and I learned so much as I try to explain in the talk. It was in fact, my time as a medical student inspired us to want to create molecular prosthetics, which in turn is what inspired us to create the Lego chemistry. So I'm a big fan as a young person, you should try to expose yourself to as many inspiring situations as possible. If you think you want to be a doctor, try to find a way to shadow a doctor in the hospital. If you think you might want to be a chemist, try to find a way to see what chemists do. Because I think seeing what different people actually do for a living on a daily basis, that's the way you figure out, you know, who am I and what do I want to be when I grow up? So for me, that turned out to be organic chemistry because of the impact factor. And I think exposing young people to as many different career paths as possible is really, really important.
Thank you. The next question is from Dr. Ashok Vaidya. Dr. Vaidya, you can, you're now the co-host. You can switch on your video and ask.
My video can be, yes. My video is on?
No, we can't see you.
Because I am trying, but it is blocked by host.
No, you're the co-host now. So you will be able to switch on. You should be able to switch on your video.
I'm starting, but it's not coming. Because host has stopped it.
It's okay. I think you can ask question.
Professor Vaidya, we can hear you.
You don't want to see me. I can understand that. But okay.
You're the
co-host. I think you can ask a question.
You know, Martin, congratulations for really a symphony presentation of a wonderful way of what I would say phytomimetics and even zoomimetics and even mycomimetics, because I think that the entire field of natural products is often neglected because of the availability of the plants, isolation of the molecules, the stereochemistry of the molecules. And I think that the new path you have started can be coupled. So my question is, how we have discussed in the path with you and Mukund both about reverse pharmacology. For example, you were asked a question about COVID-19. A BRC scientist had shown in hundreds of patients that neem extract really works on them. And this is done in a hospital, COVID hospital itself. But she is reluctant to come out with it because the government of India may say you have not followed the protocol. We know that neem contains antiviral compounds. Same way endographists panniculatize endographolide, which is also very active. And another is geraniol, and particularly from the plant Phyllanthus amarus, which is also active in GP120 binding, and that is blocked, and that is also needed in HIV, HBV, as well as in corona COVID-19 virus. What I'm afraid is that this tremendous therapeutic wisdom in India is completely lost on the US science. Just a month back, we had a discussion with NIH and National Cancer Institute, and they were not aware of any work going on in India at all. And Mukund has been our ambassador, but I think it is uphill task for him also. So I want your opinion, how we, our group and others, entire clinical pharmacology, reverse pharmacology, has found activity, incontrovertible activity clinically. How can that knowledge of a plant and plant molecule can be quickly converted into natural drugs? Thank you.
Professor Vaidya, thank you so much for the very thoughtful question and for all of your partnership and engagement along this journey. We agree with you. There is so much untapped potential in natural products, including thousands of years of history of medicinal plants and utilizations that we don't understand what the molecules are and what they're doing. And if we could, there's tremendous untapped potential there from a therapeutic perspective. Our hope is that if we can create a much more accessible platform for molecular synthesis, many more of those key components can be identified, scaled up, tested, and thereby applied as medicines. And this is, I think, one of the most exciting frontiers that better access to molecule making could open. Because as your question points out, and as you pioneer, these are secrets that are embedded in culture, in history, in, you know, what people know all throughout different spaces, where sometimes that information is not known amongst those who are choosing which projects to work on to try to develop the next treatments. If we can democratize molecular innovation, we unleash the creative power and the knowledge and the history that you're speaking of. So I know it's a longer term answer to your question, but that's where we are hoping to contribute, is that by making molecule synthesis available to everyone, we can leverage so much of that untapped imagination potential, which includes so many of these medicinal natural products that the world doesn't yet have in its toolbox when we treat different diseases. So I'm very excited to try to help make a contribution in the perspective of making the molecule making process more accessible so that these barriers that you're describing can be broken down.
Thank you, Martin. I'm very much impressed by the paintings at the back of you. a burst of creativity, maybe one of your children have done that, but amazing paintings at the background. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Brady. I'll share with you. So I do have two little artists in my family. They will tell you this is not my office. This is their museum. And they've taken over the whole thing. So they actually have a wall-to-wall cover of all of my office. So I agree. Their imaginations are so inspiring, right? Like, unlike us, as we get older, we tend to get kind of tunnel visioned. Children just go for it, right? They have no barriers when they think about creating, and we can learn a lot from them. I agree with you.
Thank you, Dr. Vaidya. Thank you, Professor Martin. The last question, I'll take the last question, and then because we are running short of time, I have lined up a lot of questions, but I will ask you only one. When you talk about small molecules, how small are these in terms of, say, nanometers or in terms of Dalton's, if you can just, tell us.
Sure. So the really exciting part, we're actually talking about an order of angstroms, right? So when you think about a small molecule, you go from, let's say 500 angstroms, one nanometer. I mean, these are extremely small things. And that puts us into an incredibly exciting space, right? Again, if we go back to where I started, on the macroscopic scale, we as a society have gotten very good at innovating. And arguably, again, for 3 million years, we have been innovating on the macroscopic scale. When we start talking about molecules, right, we're now on the angstrom or even nanometer or angstrom scale. And we've only been doing it for 200 years. So if you think about the untapped potential, I mean, that is like a blip on the time scale of human history. So we've barely scratched the surface of what's possible with these extremely small tools that could impact so many of the unsolved challenges we're facing in society today. And so if you couple that untapped potential to the untapped imaginations of 7.5 billion people around the world, putting those things together, we think represents an incredibly exciting future. And we're really looking forward to figuring out together how we can make that happen.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Martin. And now, if you'll permit me, I would like to play the video which Dr. Mashalkar has shared with us. Just give me a moment. And Professor Martin, if I can share your email ID with the participants, they have a lot of questions. If they can write to you and you can answer them, if that is okay.
Of course. Thanks so much.
Thank you. My screen is visible to all, right?
Yes.
I'm absolutely delighted that Professors Varsha Kerkermani, Mukund Chorgade, Suhas Pennekar, and industry experts like Uday Ole have convened and organized this spectacular welcome to such a distinguished scholar as Professor Martin Berg to enlighten us on the twin concepts of Mecha Labs and Dolphin Tank to achieve disruptive innovations in healthcare. In the yesteryear's millennia, human medicine was centered around physician-led restoration of health in patients after they became sick. We stand at the dawn of an exciting era of democratization of healthcare, where individuals, families, and communities are empowered to play leadership roles in actively promoting their own health, pioneering technologies that have affected a sea change. And this revolution, allied with extraordinary levels of disruptive innovations, have transformative potential to achieve better healthcare for more people, more and more people at lower and lower cost. Synthetic chemists have been adept and best in the world of making things from the molecular to the macroscopic scale. New medical Mecha Lab will leverage this extraordinary strength. I enthusiastically call upon the University of Mumbai and others to join this global quest. Let us build facilities that house state-of-the-art automated fabrication equipment, professional staff to operate and maintain them, and educational programs that collectively enable non-specialists, like, for example, students, postdoctoral fellows, biomedical and non-medical, biomedical scientists and engineers and citizen scientists, example, community residents across all demographies. And they all can work together to transform far-reaching ideas about health and healing in prototypes. I'm a strong proponent and a cheerleader of our academic, industrial, and government initiatives to democratize health innovation by empowering non-specialists and citizen scientists in identifying and solving frontier challenges in human health. Let us create an international health innovation ecosystem that enables great ideas to be transformed into radical breakthroughs in health and well-being by fostering translational research across engineering, across humanity, across arts and physical life, behavioral and social sciences. In India and China, the Oriental medicine laid more stress on the maintenance of positive health and prevention of diseases rather than cure of diseases. Therefore, yoga, tai chi, healthy lifestyles, individualized nutrition, seasonal regimens, and the use of easily available minerals, animal products, medicinal plants, and spices got incorporated for health into the daily life of the community. The corpus of health wisdom grew steadily over the centuries, and the Orient prospered immensely by productive endeavor of healthy citizens who lived long and in harmony. As Dr. Ashok Vaidya, our great guru, has opined, there is ignorance in the West of the profound epistemology of Ayurveda and its pragmatic principles and practices. To quicken the pace of human engineering-based healing, the available robust bedside hits and leads from Ayurvedic health measures, drugs and non-drugs, will have to be investigated with a transcultural sensitivity and scientific objectivity. The value of well-documented clinical leads is immense, as the activity and safety in humans are the starting points. People need to be involved in self-care for health. Let us once again listen to patients who get well by health interventions aligned to our current dogma of cure. Affordable and easily available, experience-based, but engineering-enhanced innovations will have a transformative impact on the health of our Indian citizens. I'm an eternal optimist, people call me a dangerous optimist, who believes, first, in evidence-based Ayurveda, second, in novel phytopharmaceutical drugs for all systems of medicine, third, nutraceuticals for health, fourth, future novel scaffolds for new chemical entities, and fifth, small molecules functioning for absent proteins that will result in setting up a maker lab at the University of Mumbai. Such a bedside to bench approach will be very successful in India using the maker labs and dolphin tank concepts. Thank you, Varsha. Thank you, Uday, for co-convening this remarkable lecture filled with innovative and game-changing thoughts by a pioneer himself. I am very enthusiastic about this, and I will support it to the hilt, I assure you. Finally, let me end by wishing you and your beloved family a happy festival of life, full of prosperity, health, happiness, and above all, peace and tranquility. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. That was Mashalkar, sir. And then I think the floor is now Professor Ole, Uday Ole, it's all yours. He's my co-convener and the co-host for today.
Thank you, Dr. Varsha. Let me begin with thanking University of Mumbai, our Vice-Chancellor, Professor Pednekar, and Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Professor Kulkarni, for giving this opportunity to tie up with Think. And when I talk about Think, Think is a society, a non-profit organization which we have started. Dr. Chorgade is the primary motivator along with this and the chief scientific person behind Think. Think is associated with technology, health, innovation, health, novelty, and quality. The idea of Think was to promote basic research in the field of holistic health with primary focus on Ayurveda through the modern scientific techniques. And the idea was to catalyze this research into entrepreneurship, to help commercialize this research by enhancing skills and getting a platform or creating a platform for skilled individuals from various walks of life to help commercialize the research. Because commercializing the research, we feel, is an ideal way to strengthening the base of the research, as more and more funding, primary funding, will be available with the researchers if we are able to commercialize the research. And the strategy is to harness the wisdom gained from reverse pharmacology. We just heard Dr. Ashok Vaidya, who is the father of reverse pharmacology. Now we need to harness the wisdom gained from him and the Roche's of India, along with the chemistry of hybrid molecules, small molecules, to develop novel approaches to meet the unmet medical needs. And then we, I think, have an access to about 50 to 70 distinguished scientists across disciplines and world-class laboratories, educational institutes, etc. Now, in this effort of catalyzing entrepreneurship, I think the first lecture by Professor Martin Burt has been very important. And Professor Burt, we at Think stand squarely behind you in supporting your adventure and your venture of Dolphin Tank as well as Maker's Lab. We look forward to have more association both with the University of Illinois, Professor Martin Burt, and of course, we would like to work more and more with University of Mumbai. Thank you.
Yeah, I think before we close, Professor Martin, we will like to see you very soon receiving Nobel Prize for your contribution in organic chemistry.
It will be generations getting Nobel Prize.
Vice Chancellor Prendergast, thank you so much again for the incredibly kind invitation and for hosting me. I'm extremely grateful for the chance to speak again with your esteemed colleagues, your amazing students, and all of the brilliant imaginations on this call. And Professor Kelkar, thank you so much again for your kind hosting of the seminar. Professor O'Hiley and Professor Torghatti, as always, I thank you for your tremendous colleagueship, your friendship, and your unwavering, passionate support for this movement since the day it began. And it's been just amazing working with you. I can't tell you how much I appreciate everything that you do to empower and enable it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And we'll definitely meet again to explore the possibilities, what we can do together with the University of Mumbai. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. I have shared Professor Martin's email ID, and please feel free to write to him. Thank you all. Thank you, VC sir. Thank you, Pro VC sir. Thank you, Professor Chaudhary.
Thank you.
And Professor Martin.
Thank you.
And thank you. The wonderful audience.
Thank you. And thank you, Professor Chaudhary. I'll be in touch with you later.
Sometime also, you know, unfortunately, what was planned for 2 years didn't quite materialize. But Marty, you are assured of an extraordinarily warm welcome in Mumbai and beyond.
Thank you again. Thank you.